There are several different ways an SMSF can invest in property these days. And to discuss some of the ways you can invest in property, I have Lauren Ryan from Think Tank with me today. Welcome, Lauren.
Thanks, Darren. Thanks for having me. I think last time we were here, about 18 months ago, Jonathan was speaking, so I'm sure he's quite happy to have me in his place today.
Indeed, indeed. So why don't we start with some of the more common ways an SMSF can invest in property?
Sure. So SMSFs can invest in property either directly through purchasing a property outright using the funds within the SMSF. They can leverage through an SMSF and purchase a property direct through a limited recourse borrowing arrangement. And they can also invest either in pooled funds or syndicated unit trusts or fractionalized property funds, whereby they own a piece of the asset. So that can either be through a fractionalized platform where they can purchase a variety of different properties, and it's often that they purchase the debt within those properties where the property is the underlying security, or they can get together with some of their fellow investors and purchase a single asset through a syndicated unit trust, or they can invest in the debt again through mortgage funds. And through those mortgage funds, you can have commercial property, residential property, and development and construction funding. So there is a variety of ways that they can get access to the underlying property.
Okay, one of the things you mentioned there was limited recourse borrowing arrangements, or LRBAs. Now, there's a bit of a misconception, I think, that most people use that avenue to invest in residential property, but that's not necessarily the case, is it?
No, it's not. There has been a lot of talk around the misuse of LRBAs to purchase off-the-plan residential property, and that being the only asset within a fund. There's no doubt that that has happened, and that has caused some issues for people. But in terms of actually using the LRBA, a lot of the funds, at least a lot of the SMSF LRBAs that we see, are for commercial purpose, and it's so that the business can then operate out of that property itself. So it's not necessarily to go and purchase a single asset. And in a lot of cases, especially the LRBAs that we see in our business, the LVRs are quite low. So there's a fair bit of cash going into the property as equity in the first place. And there's also other assets within the fund. So it's not always used to purchase a single asset and have that asset as the entirety of the fund. Mm-hmm. It's often used as a diversification strategy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, part of the problem with LRBAs at the moment is that not a lot of organisations are actually offering that type of funding, but Think Tank does have an LRBA solution for SMSFs out there. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. So we started offering LRBAs in 2013, so we aren't a new entrant into this market. And you're right, Darren, quite a few of the banks that offered these products pulled out about 12, 18 months ago. And there were quite a few other lenders that also offered these kind of products and pulled out. But Think Tank's been offering traditionally commercial LRBAs since 2013 because we are traditionally a commercial lender. And as I mentioned earlier, the benefit of that is that business owners can then operate their business out of that property, whereas in residential, it has to be an investment only.
Yeah.
We've only recently opened up SMSF Resi for investment purposes. So the core business has been commercial, but we are building up that Resi SMSF part of our book.
Yeah.
And quite a few of the non-banks have also been doing LRBAs and SMSF lending for quite some time, but there has been a focus on the banks. And I think there's a bit of consumer misunderstanding that only the banks offered these products, whereas there are a lot of the non-banks that they deal a lot with brokers rather than direct to customer. So when the banks pulled out, customers weren't aware of a lot of the other offerings, whereas the brokers certainly are. And now as Think Tank and some other non-bank lenders are having more of a B2C marketing and business awareness approach, there are more consumers recognizing that there have been lenders out there offering these kind of products for quite some time, and that we aren't just jumping on the back of a bank pullout. We've been experts in this for 6-7 years.
Can you tell us some of the terms that you offer with your LRBA offering?
Sure. So on the commercial side, we offer up to 30-year loan term. So it's a 5-year interest only, and then 25 years P&I if the borrower chooses. So it's very similar to a residential home loan.
Right.
Our max LVR is 75%, And one of our quite interesting products on the commercial side is that we can also fund the GST component for borrowers. So if you're a business owner and you're going to purchase an SMSF property and then move into it, it's considered vacant at the time of purchase and you need to pay GST. A lot of small businesses, they would prefer the cash flow. So where that business meets our credit criteria, we can actually extend them for 5 months, the GST component on top, because we know that that refund is coming back from the ATO once the business activity statement is complete. And then that allows the business to use the cash flow within their business rather than having it tied up in the SMSF. So in our commercial lending, we can do up to $3 million in lending. We need 2 years financials, and we often need an SOA from the financial advisor. So we need buy-in that the accountant and the advisor are on board with the borrower's plan here, and that we know that the borrower's got some sound advice around them. So that's on the commercial side. On the resi side, we can do 70% interest only for apartments, and our max lend on resi is $1.5 million. So we are much more conservative on that side in terms of the overall lend. Still a 30-year term, 5-year interest only. Of course, that's only for investment purposes, and that's a legal thing, not a think tank thing. On the P&I, we can go up to 75% on apartments, and for houses, we can go up to 80%. So I have heard of some, there are quite a few, I listen to a lot of podcasts, and there are a lot of podcasts out there, and I've heard that people are talking about SMSF lending being restricted to 60 and 65.
Yeah.
And that's just not necessarily the case with Think Tank. We are quite cautious when we're doing resi SMSF for investment. And as I said, a lot of the LVRs that we're getting are quite low.
Yeah.
But we do have that appetite to go a bit higher where we see opportunity there.
Now, we started this conversation about different ways SMSFs could invest in properties. And of course, you obviously offer a managed fund as well where investors can buy a property or participate in that asset class via bonds.
Yep.
How does that structure work, and what sort of properties do you include in that portfolio?
So we have two trusts for private clients. We're currently only open to high net wealth clients. So our income fund is our first mortgage fund, returning 4.19% at the moment. And that invests in commercial property, which is made up of industrial, office, retail, and motel, and some residential as well. So it's about 50-50 split there. And our high yield fund, which is, as I said, where we funded those GST top-up loans, again, is only open to high net wealth, but that's about a, the loans in that fund is about 18 months. So we ask for a 12-month commitment from our investors, and that fund's returning 7.09% at the moment. So it technically, it's a second mortgage fund, but a second mortgage to Think Tank.
Right.
So the way that our funding works is we get a large portion of our funding from the institutions. So the bank warehouse would fund the first 75% of that loan, and then the high yield trust investors would fund the second mortgage piece, the additional up to 10% top up. So investors can take comfort that it's all Think Tank originated, all Think Tank underwritten, all Think Tank collected, and that the big banks are in that loan with us. And because it's an 18-month loan, there is a lot of liquidity within the fund, so we are able to offer investors a 12-month minimum.
Yeah.
And the transaction size to get into property can be quite large, so we can offer investors a $10,000 entry point so they can get to know us, get to trust us, get to like us, and then build up their portfolio if they see fit. But they are pooled mortgage funds, so you're invested, you're exposed to all of the loans within that pool rather than just having that single asset exposure which you get when you purchase an individual property.
Right. Now, usually through a managed fund structure, you're talking about buying units, but in your offerings, you actually purchase bonds. How does that structure, how advantageous is that structure? What benefits does that bring?
Yeah, the way that our product's structured is investors are exposed to, or they own a percentage of the fund. So if the fund's got X million dollars, $50 million, let's say, and they invest $100,000, they're exposed to quite a small percentage of the overall fund.
Mm-hmm.
So they still get, all investors get the same return.
Yeah.
The capital doesn't change like a traditional bond does.
Yeah.
But if there is a situation where there are losses, which haven't happened in our 13-year history, but if mm-hmm. that happens, then the losses would get prorated as per a percentage of ownership from each investor. Whereas if you go into a unit trust and buy a property, one, you're exposed to that single property, and your risk of losing capital if that property doesn't quite perform is a lot greater, because mm-hmm. you've probably got quite maybe 10 or so investors all chipping in $100,000 to buy one property. So your exposure is a lot higher. Whereas in our fund, because there's quite a large funds under management, $100,000 or $200,000 or a $10,000 investment is quite a low percentage of your capital at risk. And as I said, we haven't had any losses in that 13-year period, but from a worst-case scenario point of view, that's where investors can take a bit more comfort.
Okay, great. Well, thanks for that, Lauren. That was very informative.
No, thanks, Darren.